multi-million ears. That's a malt mention. And thank you to Olavi Hartinen, who comes from Finland, just checking, for that malt mention. Oh yes, so thank you, Olavi. And you may be interested to know that I'm going to review a whisky now. Here it is, as I generally waft my hands towards the direction of the bottle and then, totally without warning, grab it, yank the cork off and pour myself a dram. Wonderful stuff. Hold the bottle up for you. This is Deanston 12-year-old Highland single malt whisky. It's 12 years old. It's bottled at 46.3%. It is unchill filtered, and they are claiming that it's natural colour. All good stuff, and I'll tell you why. If you had come across Deanston in the old days, before malt whisky became outrageously fashionable and some of it outrageously expensive, well, you'd have been hard pushed to find Deanston. It was essentially a malt distillery producing exclusively for blended whisky. In fact, originally Deanston didn't used to be a distillery at all. It was a factory that was converted to a distillery, and this distillery retains a certain characteristic of having a working water wheel which generates power for the distillery. Excellent stuff, I commend that. And I also commend Burn Stewart, the producers of Deanston, for taking a fairly dull old Cinderella malt, which was, as I've said, used virtually for blend filler, and that was it, and basically reinventing it very successfully. This is a kind of fairly recent phenomenon across the Burn Stewart range, with Bunahabhain now in a craft presentation, and also probably the most unglamorous single malt you would ever find on a supermarket shelf, which was Tobermory. But what a difference to that whisky as well, with this updated contemporary packaging presentation, and I would call it respect for the customer. Deanston isn't a complex malt. It's biscuity, slightly yeasty. It has a few little vanilla honey notes, but it's certainly not got the dynamics of Ardbeg or Longmorn or Glen Grant once it's older, or even Springbank. It's just not in their league when it comes to natural complexity. However, when you take what is a fairly simple single malt and you invest in the intrinsic quality, it's amazing how the whole experience is elevated. And that's really what I'm going to kind of highlight with my tasting notes here and my malt marks. Yes, malt marks, malt marks, malt marks. Better get them ready. Here we go. Yep, no problem. Nose. A real warm richness. Slightly spicy, gingery biscuit. You're really getting, it's the flavour of malted barley grain that dominates the first impression of the nose. And whereas it used to be kind of fairly thin, now it's so much richer. It's got so much more body to it in the nose. It really has given a simple malt room to express its natural complexity. Now, this has been brought about because it isn't chill filtered, which strips away some of the positivity of the whisky, and it's not had the brown dye added, which kind of just basically gives you false readings as to what the whisky's about. And also, importantly, bit more alcohol. As I always say, more alcohol, more flavour, and it's true. Honey, citrus honey, a certain smoky oak wood, recharred casks, but also you really notice fresh filled bourbon casks. And that gingery note in the nose becomes more floral, more honeysuckle, more vanilla. There's cologne as well. Interesting, slightly peppery cologne note on the nose, which is kind of hard to spot behind the kind of the full-on effect of the grain itself, the graininess. But very interesting indeed. Fudge, some gentle almond marzipan, some bitter almond, and some white wine port. White port. Now, we tend to assume that port's a kind of red, rich, coloured red, fortified wine. But you do get tawny ports, and importantly, you will come across occasionally white ports, which, by the way, are well worth looking out for. It's a fascinating nose. It gets even better once you add water, because some of the very light, and I wouldn't add too much, I've added a teaspoon, we'll leave it at that, but when you add water, initially there's a kind of slight sharpness, the citrus is accentuated, but once you give it about 10 minutes, there's a certain lush, natural grain sweetness kind of starts to come in from the background, and it really does, it basically makes a simple malt simply excellent. Taste. Citrusy, almost sharp, slightly salty, big grain arrival. Slightly yeasty. You get the kind of yeast note in there, but it's not unpleasant because it's so well ingrained with the actual malted barley. And it evolves bittersweet, some chamomile, so the wee bit of floral that you got in the nose appears again in the palate. Lemon rind, honey sour, and some camphory wintergreen, you know, the dentist mouthwash, but more kind of soft citrus, camphorish, so not too aromatic, much more subdued. And then the finish is relatively mild. I'm not going to fault the finish, because it's still a 12 year old malt, and for the price you're paying, it actually delivers more than some of the more reputable malts which have had the caramel added, which have been chill filtered and are bottled at 40%. And here's the rub. It really is a challenge you've got to set yourself, whether you are fashion driven and basically following the orthodoxy as to which whiskies you prefer, because some of the biggest malt names out there are actually bottling some, and I'm stressing this, just some of what they bottle is, in my opinion, not that great. Some of other stuff what they bottle is excellent, no quibbles, but some isn't that great. It's certainly acceptable, but when you get this premium pricing that's going on to the most prolific, high-profile marketed brands, there's other whiskies out there, and I think you should give them your attention, and Deanston's one of them. It's not all singing, all dancing malt, but thanks to the virtue of being more naturally craft-presented, you're simply getting a better version of what's already there. I tend to think, actually, with the Deanston, they've also been using more volume of fresh fill bourbon casks to kind of beef up the signature. It's worked, by the way, well matured, beautifully married together, a real alternative personality single malt whiskey. And the finish, oh, the citrus. I'm really noticing that more and more, that kind of almost Pulteney-esque sour citrus with a hint of salt to it, as you get an old Pulteney. Have I got that the wrong right way around? Yes, I do. Mild and fairly simple finish, but there's a touch of bitter toffee, natural bitter toffee, and a certain mineral flintiness in the finish as well that you pick up on. But a great session dram, well worth exploring, and it really, really benefits. To the tune of 88 out of 100 malt mark, from the fact that this is a craft presented single malt. I do get asked, Ralphie, should I buy independent bottlings of whiskies if, for example, I like Highland Park? With the price of the official bottlings, particularly the older ones, should I buy an independent bottling? And the answer is, yeah, go ahead, do your online research. Right, and applies, I'm talking about Highland Park, but applies for any whiskey, any single malt. Do your online research with the likes of Whiskey Fun, the Malt Maniacs and Whiskey Base, the big sort of databases of opinion, and then decide, well, we've got a sherried Highland Park or a bourbon Highland Park. Highland Park tends to suit sherry maturation as a single cask whiskey rather than bourbon. I know that from experience. Same with Aberlour, same with Glen Grant. But the independent bottlings, they're not chill filtering generally. They're giving you a more honest, natural presentation of the whiskies, and that is still the big ace card that the independent bottlers can play when it comes to soliciting your attention and perhaps your business. But I would love to see more single malts presented this way, and that is why I'm mentioning it, repeating myself slightly here with this review, because I don't think quite enough whiskies are given a natural craft presentation by virtue, of course, that sales are apparently so good at the moment, but they're not going to be around forever. Distilleries can build up for increased demand, but there will be tougher times ahead, and every encouragement that distillers get to naturally present their whiskey, all the better as far as I'm concerned, all the better. So there you have it, folks, another whiskey vlog, number 309, because I don't think I mentioned that at the beginning of the vlog. Well, this all completed now, all done and dusted. Is there anything else that I want to add before I say cheerio, switch off the camera and go and have myself a hot cup of tea? Let me see now. Dum dum dum. I've emphasised that compared to the older versions of Deanston, this is a huge improvement. And I'm going to come back to this shortly, in fact, probably my next review with Tobermory, and tell you a bit of the Tobermory story. Tobermory story, there we are. A little bit of, not quite a rhyming couplet, but we're getting there. And just how much that whisky has improved recently. Yeah, I've mentioned everything. That's been done and dusted. Job done. Mission accomplished. Glad you could join me, and I'm happy to be helpful. And if you fancy another whiskey moment before too long, well, you know where to visit. Yes, it's where the malt stuff's happening. Independent. Yes. Not a lot of industry samples end up in this table. No, no, no. Few and far between, because quite simply, I do believe that it is better for you that I review the whiskey that's actually bottled and put on the shelves of shops, rather than the flattering samples, as can happen, not all the time, but it can happen, the flattering samples provided by the producers. Why do they do it? Because they're running a business. I'm not blaming them, not being critical. When you're running a business, you look after business. Simple as that. I'll be looking after business shortly in Whisky Review 310. Join me then when I shall review another single malt from Scotland. Brilliant.